A grande mídia continua a equiparar o feminismo em si com o feminismo liberal. Longe de oferecer uma solução, contudo, o feminismo liberal é parte do problema. Centrado no norte global, entre a camada gerencial profissional, ele está voltado para a imposição e a quebra do telhado de vidro, dedicado a permitir que um pequeno número de mulheres privilegiadas escale a hierarquia corporativa e os escalões das forças armadas. Esse feminismo propõe uma visão de igualdade baseada no mercado, que se harmoniza perfeitamente com o entusiasmo corporativo vigente pela diversidade. Embora condene a discriminação e defenda a liberdade de escolha, o feminismo liberal se recusa firmemente a tratar das restrições socioeconômicas que tornam a liberdade e o empoderamento impossíveis para uma ampla maioria de mulheres. Seu verdadeiro objetivo não é igualdade, mas meritocracia. Em vez de buscar abolir a hierarquia social, visa diversificá-la, empoderando mulheres talentosas para ascender ao topo. Seu caso de amor com avanço individual permeia igualmente o mundo das celebridades das mídias sociais, que também confunde feminismo com a ascensão de mulheres enquanto indivíduos. Nesse mundo, o feminismo corre o risco de se tornar uma hashtag do momento e um veículo de autopromoção, menos aplicada a libertar a maioria do que a promover a minoria. No Tese 11 de hoje, a gente conversa com Cíntia Arusa, uma das autoras de Feminismo para os 99%, um manifesto.
Hi, Sabrina. I'm Cinzia Ruzza. I teach at the New School for Social Research in New York, but I'm originally from Italy, and I'm a feminist and socialist activist, and one of the organizers of the women's strike in the United States in 2017 and 2018.
The first thing that I wanted to talk to you about actually has to do with something I heard you say when I was watching this video. I don't remember where the video is, but I do remember I had made notes about it, and you had something to say about the relationship between Marxism and feminism. And you said that it was a hate-love relationship, but it was also a necessary relationship. Could you talk a little bit about that?
I wrote a little book, which is an introduction meant for activists, and about the dangerous liaisons between Marxism and feminism. And by this I meant, first of all, the fact that if we look at the history of the workers' movement and of socialism, we do have some kind of hate-love relationship with feminism, in the sense that on the one hand, every social revolution that, from Russia to China to the civil war in Spain and so on, also offered an opportunity for women to, gain unprecedented rights. So, for example, in the first year of the Russian Revolution, in 2018, we have the first really progressive family code that was, that abolished basically the patriarchal family. And Soviet Russia was the first country to legalize abortion. So on the one hand, we have this enormous fruitful encounter between worker struggles and the liberation, women's liberation, but not only women, because, for example, another thing that the Russian Revolution did was to decriminalize homosexuality until it was recriminalized again by Stalin. Like other historical examples have to do with, the German Social Democracy was the first party in Germany to campaign for the women's right to vote. Not even the liberal feminist movement was campaigning for the right to vote, but the social democracy was the German social democracy was doing it. So on the one hand, we have this story that very often is neglected or also negated, of of actually interconnection between women's liberation and the strive for universal emancipation and the workers' movement and the socialist movement, and also social revolutions. At the same time, the socialist movement and the workers' movement, of course, was part of this reality, and therefore, and it was made by people who were clearly subject to, sexist ideology, or had, sexist habits, and so on. They were, living in the world as the world was and still is, which means that we also have instances of really, misogyny, sexism, undervaluation of women's struggles within the socialist and workers' movement as well. And we could, you know, make several examples about this. And especially during the second feminist wave, we had, you know, really a divorce in a sense between feminism on the one hand and the workers' movement on the other. And we still have today this kind of debates in the sense, you know, for example, around the women's strike, there is, you know, debates in various countries within the left, with you know, people in the left supporting very reductionist views of class struggle, so denying that, you know, that feminist struggle is part of class struggle, or you know, being suspicious against women's, you know, feminist strikes and so on. And then from the viewpoint of theory, I think, you know, on the one hand, I think that Marxist feminism really developed some crucial categories to understand gender oppression under capitalism. On the other hand, it is also true that this is a very underdeveloped area within Marxist theory. So we have, you know, a lot of Marxist men working on all possible topics within Marxist theory, but still very few working on gender oppression. This is starting to change now. So there is clearly a lack of development of feminist theory, a properly Marxist feminist theory, on issues like, you know, rape, gender violence, for example, we have very little. We still have not enough on the interconnection between race and gender. We still have not enough on sexuality and sexual identity. So there is a lot of work to be done. Basically.
That's positive though, right? I'm always concerned when people come to me and they watch my channel or they come to one of my lectures and they expect these ready-made answers. They're like, Marxism has all of the answers. Everything has been fixed already. And now all we have to do is implement it, right? So I think it's kind of positive and has to do with the dialectical movement of learning and practice. And I think this is one of the things that, unfortunately, we've had troubles here in Brazil related to the workers' movement and socialist movements and organizations in general, where we still hear these things about, wow, it's the feminists. The feminists are dividing the class. Yes. And, yes, it's really hard for us to actually to be able to organize and to show them in practice that the working class is very much made up by women as well. And this is all interconnected. And this resistance, do you find, like you mentioned a little bit about that, but you've been traveling a lot as well, right? I know you were throughout Latin America, you were here in Brazil before. And do you see this resistance in most of the organizations?
I mean, I wouldn't say most of the organizations. This would be actually unfair. And I think there are a lot of political organizations from the left that in a number of countries actually have made a very clear decision of investing in the feminist movement. So no, I wouldn't say, I mean, I'm more optimistic about this. I wouldn't say that the large majority of left organizations still have this kind of reductionist positions. But I would say that in every country, there is still this problem. In other words, there is still, you know, like, a sector of the left that continues to speak about, you know, the divisiveness of feminism or anti-racism, without understanding that it's not feminism or anti-racism that divides us or divides the unity of the class. It is capitalism that divides the unity of the class through sexism and through racism. So, you know, and the only way to address this is precisely by developing a class struggle, a feminist and class struggle, anti-racism and so on. So I'm a bit optimistic, but I also think that there is quite an amount of work to do. And this will be crucial, especially for the labor movement, for unions, particularly because we do have a process of not only of feminization of labor, so we now have a mass of women workers around the world, but also if we look at the, you know, some of the recent strike waves, for example, in the United States, they're all taking place, most of them are taking place in the sector of social reproduction. So education, healthcare. In the United States, it was teachers. And now in tomorrow, there will be the beginning of the nurses strike in New York. And this is a very feminized workforce. So even, you know, also for the labor movement, you know, for unions, it's very important to really develop a feminist perspective, precisely because they will organize a workforce that is increasingly feminized. They should also develop an anti-racist perspective because they are also organizing increasingly a workforce that is migrant and racialized. So without addressing these issues, then also labor organizing is going to be seriously weakened and meet a series of obstacles.
Yeah, it's not going to be effective, and I think it's not going to be effective in fighting liberal feminism, which is one of the main themes of the book as well. Last year, I gave this lecture explaining to people a little bit about these different traditions within feminism, and then I was talking to a few people, and they were like, "Yeah, but you know, feminism's okay. The problem is like identity politics, and you people don't do proper feminism, which is proper feminism is only Alexandra Kollontai in people's minds." And then actually, if you quiz them, you're going to find out they never actually read Kollontai, which is a different matter. But one of the things that I told them is, well, if you want to fix the problems of liberal feminism, then we need anti-capitalist feminism to be able to flourish.
And this is basically the idea behind the manifesto we wrote, in the sense that we saw on the one hand, you know, like the problem of this hegemony of liberal feminism, basically in most advanced capitalist countries, and also like growing also in I think in Latin America and so on, and we were really concerned with the identification of feminism with liberal feminism, and therefore with the idea that, you know, all feminism is the Hillary Clinton or the Sandberg version of feminism. On the other hand, what we thought is precisely this, that the only way to fight against this kind of also, like use of liberal feminism by neoliberal forces to just, you know, to dress in pink and to be more socially acceptable while, you know, attacking the welfare state or labor conditions, and so on. But what we thought is that, you know, the only way, the effective way to push against this is actually to develop another kind of feminism and to make it hegemonic. So, in other words, to really like engage in a battle with liberal feminism over the meaning of feminism and what a proper feminist project, you know, based on the idea of the liberation of all women should be. Because I really don't think, I mean, I honestly think that, you know, the reductionist positions or dismissals of gender issues are going to just, you know, fuel liberal feminism. In other words, are going to just confirm people in the idea that Marxism or socialism have nothing to offer to women and racialized people, and these kind of positions are going to actually strengthen, you know, the liberal feminist hegemony. They're not going to be effective in fighting against it. So I don't even see, from the viewpoint of, you know, political tactics, I don't even see the advantage of taking these kind of positions, honestly.
I think that's quite problematic. Last year, we had a series of demonstrations by women fighting against Bolsonaro. And when Bolsonaro got elected, a lot of the men just said it was the women's fault because we pushed too hard. Society is not ready for that. So apparently, we're supposed to all say okay to misogyny and racism and homophobics and all of that because society is still like that. So we have to just accept it in order to fight the fascist guy. So that was one of the problems. But another problem is that we had a lot of women joining together against Bolsonaro. We still have a lot of women joining together against Bolsonaro. But now we have this whole thing that we can't really go to battle with the liberals. We can't even denounce liberal feminists because that would be a problem. Like, what are you talking about? You are feminist. Why are you denouncing this other woman? And I'm just mentioning that because I just actually made a video talking about this congresswoman who is a liberal congresswoman, and she talks about women's issues, but she's always talking about meritocracy and equal opportunity, and she's in bed with the World Bank. It's another situation. And then that reminded me of that part in the book as well, because in the beginning, I believe the three of you wrote that it had something to do with the liberal feminism is always talking about equal opportunity for domination, right? Yes,
exactly. I mean, this, clearly there is, you know, a pressure because of the rise of the far right in a number of countries, like Brazil, but also, you know, Italy, for example. There is, you know, like then a pressure to like reach some kind of unity among women, regardless of what kind of feminism they are supporting, against this rise of the far right. I think it is a mistake. In other words, just to explain better, I mean, I do think, you know, a class struggle feminist movement should push back against, you know, sexist attacks against liberal feminists and so on, because any kind of sexist attack against a woman has consequences for all women, and therefore they need to be pushed back. At the same time, I think it is important to develop autonomous political strategy, program, and organizing, because in a sense, what we write in the manifesto, for example, is that, you know, like if we take progressive neoliberalism, so you know, this kind of neoliberal democratic parties that around the world pushed, you know, austerity and attacks on the welfare state, you know, cuts on public funds and so on, and covered themselves with this, you know, pink veneer like women's rights or women's equal opportunity and so on. Our idea, our thesis is that actually this kind of progressive neoliberalism has indeed enabled the rise of a far right, but then clearly doesn't really represent an alternative to neoliberalism. It's just another neoliberal project, but it is basically presenting itself as an alternative to neoliberalism, and it does so by identifying neoliberalism with identity politics, with, you know, women's freedoms, with, you know, the so-called gender ideology, so, or LGBTQ rights and so on. So, and in this way, of course, you know, it displaces frustration, social frustrations, away from the actual issues and against queer people and women, basically, and migrants, racialized people. So from this viewpoint, it is absolutely important to develop a different kind of feminism, a class struggle-based feminism, precisely because we are in this situation because of the also because of the cooptation of feminism and you know, of LGBTQ discourse by neoliberal forces. So we need to disentangle what, you know, sexual liberation means or women's liberation means from neoliberalism. And if we don't do this, we will just, you know, fuel the far right even more. So we need to disentangle them, and we need to reclaim feminism for a project of, you know, for an anti-capitalist project. So this entails, even in situations like Brazil, having an open, I would say, like confrontation with liberal feminism. So you can have, you know, unity of action against specific measures, specific policies, or against specific sexist attacks. So you can, you know, build still a unity of action of mobilization and so on, but with very clear, clearly distinct political positions.
This is also related to the matter of carceral feminism that you also mentioned in the book. Recently, we had this move towards criminalizing or not homophobia in Brazil, and a lot of the liberal portals, the liberal organizations, they're like, yes, criminalize it. And not thinking, for example, how strongly this is connected to racism.
Also, for example, on an issue like, you know, the carceral solution to gender violence or to homophobia and so on, I think we really need to be in opposition, in open political opposition against this kind of politics, because I mean, it is based on, first of all, I mean, there is no carceral solution to deeply rooted social problems. There is no way. Either we transform social relations, or it is certainly not an increase in repression that will help us. But secondly, you know, if we look This is a bit of a general feature of you know the repressive apparatus and the police and the judiciary. Don't, you know, in basically most of countries. I mean, they are not really friends of women or gay people, queer people. They're actually part of the problem. I mean, we do have not only instances of direct police brutality and rape against incarcerated women or women under arrest and so on. If we take as an example the judiciary, I mean, the way in which rape cases of rape are handled with the continuous victim, you know. Continuous blaming the victim for her behavior, the way she dressed, what she did, what she drank, maybe she, and justifying the perpetrator as he lost his mind for a moment, he had, you know, he drank, and so on. So, I mean, all of this, if we look concretely at what happens also in cases of domestic abuse, domestic violence, and so on. I mean, it's a bit disingenuous to think that the police is our friend, is our friend, and that we should rely on them, and so on. And with this, I don't mean to say that you know women should not report cases of domestic abuse or violence or rape and so on. But this clearly, women should do what they think is best for them in given circumstances. In political terms, clearly this is not a solution. And then there is the problem of race, as you said. In other words, I mean, in the United States, we have a long history of, you know, of the myth of the black rapist, which Angela Davis, for example, writes, and so on. So, fake rapes and so on were used systematically to justify lynching and to initiate lynching of black people. And we have a similar process in Europe, for example, now with the wave of immigration, where the issue of gender violence is used constantly as a way to criminalize immigrant men. So every case of rape perpetrated by immigrants is immediately in all media. When, you know, while at the same time a number of other cases perpetrated by family members are not made public and so on. And it is constantly used to pass security laws that criminalize and oppress immigrant communities or to have even stricter border policies and so on. So we should, as feminists, we really should be aware of this situation, of this story, also the way in which anti-trafficking laws and the discourse of, you know, against sexual slavery is used to actually further criminalize immigration. I mean, we have lots of testimonies from immigrant sex workers speaking about the fact that this is clearly not the solution. The criminalization is not the solution because actually, what the process is usually end up with deportation of the migrant woman as well. So, I mean, not being aware of this, of all this complexity, and to continue to insist on repressive solutions, I think is at best disingenuous. So, at the very least, you know, it's very, you know, race blind.
Yes. Switching topics a little bit, not directly related to the book, but in the book, you mentioned trans women. I've heard you talk about trans women as women and the importance for cis women to engage in solidarity and recognize trans women within the feminist movement. And that reminds me with a little bit of the rhetoric that I get from radical feminists in Brazil, but also when I used to live in Canada. That's related to the fact, this criticism. So I'm going to get a little bit into theory right now that, well, but aren't you materialists? Because if you are a materialist, then you need to recognize that this is about uteruses and vulvas and vaginas. So how come you're saying you're a Marxist feminist and you're talking about historical materialism? If it's about materialism, why are you talking about trans women as women? And I know from like some of your work, like your engagement with this critique of materialist feminism. So I was hoping you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, so Marxist feminists are not materialists, they're historical materialists. There is a big difference. I mean, this has nothing to do with the biology or with, you know, like ideas of what counts as human nature or what counts as women's nature as rooted in biological facts. Historical materialism is a mode of interpretation of social relations as they constitute themselves historically, social relations of exploitation, domination, and oppression. And within these social relations, also identities and subjectivities are historically formed and shaped. So this is the opposite of, which doesn't mean that biological factors do not play a role. I mean, clearly, you know, like, for example, we do insist on the fact that issues like giving birth, so pregnancy, breastfeeding, and so on, do have an impact, do play a role in women's oppression under capitalism because of the way in which capitalist production is organized, the pressure to, you know, decrease cost of reproduction, not to pay cost of reproduction, and so on. So clearly, this, you know, there are biological elements, but they are not our destiny. They're not it's not the biological elements that define our identity or our subjectivity. This sounds quite bizarre to me to think that, I mean, clearly, you know, materialist feminism, yes, at least some branches does think that, you know, there is some truth in some transhistorical truth in biology. But I really don't see what this has to do with Marxism, honestly. Or at
I know.
I mean, it may have to do with some orthodox positivistic Marxism, yes, but not with Marx.
Yes, and when I think of it, I actually think that if this is materialism, it's exactly the kind of materialism that Marx was critiquing in Feuerbach, which is very related to this sensorial perspective. Oh, so I see this is your sexual parts and this defines the rest of it. So it's actually quite anti-Marxist if you say anything about that. So this is part of the engagement. You bring more of this discussion about Marxist trans feminism and including trans women in all of these struggles. And it's one of the problems here. It's a big problem here because trans women are very much marginalized and killed, assassinated. So this is one of the reasons why I think it's important to include this in the conversation. So thank you. Maybe if they're hearing it from you, now they're going to understand what I mean when I talk about it.
But I must also add that, you know, besides the theoretical issue, I really cannot. I mean, for me, it's really a puzzle why, you know, there is a sector of radical feminism, fortunately not all radical feminists, but a sector, a very vocal one, that thinks that our main problem as women is trans women. So an incredibly oppressed sector of society. I mean, what is wrong with this? I mean, I really don't understand what is the logic in this.
They gave me an explanation for that in the past, and they said it's the other way around, is that, well, look what you're doing. You're making feminism about men. So like their explanation is transphobic right away.
Yes.
So yeah, it's something quite concerning, and like I'm trying to help people reflect a little bit about that, because I do know that there are a lot of women who come to this idea because maybe they went through sexual violence, some sort of gender violence, and they feel the need to be protected, and sometimes they get captured by this kind of discourse. So it is important for us to deconstruct it a little bit, but also create an alternative discourse and practice related to that. So thank you for that. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about maybe, I don't want to pick, but maybe it's like my favorite chapter because this is my line of work. This is mentioned that the planet is dying, that the planet is in shambles and is going to catch on fire anytime soon. Women are going to be affected, and women are part of the solution for us to fight against climate change, ecological crisis. So if you could talk a little bit more about that, that fits perfectly within the theme of my YouTube channel and my academic work, actually.
Okay. Yeah, no, I mean, so first of all, I think that the issue of climate change should really reshape the way we think about politics in general and about, you know, also anti-capitalism, because I mean, we really are, and we tend to repress the thought. There is always this mechanism of, you know, not think, you know, repressing the thought that the planet is possibly dying, but we really need to address this issue, because this overdetermines everything else at this point. In terms of the manifesto and what we write, Our idea is that, I mean, clearly climate change affects everybody. It affects women first because of the role that women play within social reproduction. So for example, in we looked at data about climate refugees from the south, from the global south, and some estimates, I think, speak about a majority, you know, in a couple of decades, a majority of climate refugees have been a large majority, like 80% being women and children. And this has probably to do with the fact that since women are responsible for food production and access, you know, water, you know, finding clean water and so on. So really fundamental aspects of social reproduction that are immediately affected by phenomena of drought, pollution and so on, then it is especially women who are going to be immediately affected by this. So like finding themselves in the impossibility of actually providing for this, for the social reproduction of their families and so on. And it is not by chance that if you look at the number of local environmental struggles, they're very often led by women. In the United States, for example, the last big one was the struggle against the Dakota pipeline, so by Native Americans. And basically the whole movement was really fundamentally led by Native women. They were really the heart of the movement, and the same is happening, you know, in struggles in the United States on, for example, in Flint against lead in the water, like the, you know, water pollution, so on, struggles around the issue of especially in Black communities around the issue of air pollution. That causes, you know, enormous rate of asthma among Black children, and it's especially women who do this work because they are the ones who are mostly responsible for all the activities of social reproduction. So, reproducing their children, socially reproducing their children, the elderly, and so on. So yeah, so we think that an anti-capitalist feminism needs to be also eco-socialist, and therefore really tackles the problem of climate change head on.
That's wonderful. And I have one last question, actually. I just came back from Palestine, and I'm actually producing a documentary on Palestine. I talked to a lot of Palestinian women, including young women from Palestine who are discovering themselves to be feminists. And it was amazing to talk to them. But then I found myself with a problem in my hands, which is related to the lack of internationalism, but also the lack of like anti-racist, xenophobic, and actually combating Orientalism within the feminist movement. I find that a lot of the concerns that women would have in the feminist movement here in Brazil would have to do with the fact that, wow, these women are wearing hijab, of course, so this is why we have to just go and do everything to liberate them without actually considering self-determination. And I think this is something that's also present in the book related to this idea of how Islamophobia is also a part of the feminist movement, and a feminist movement that's for the 99% that makes no sense. It's we cannot have that.
Yeah, I mean, Sarah Harris has coined a term to describe this kind of feminism. It's femonationalism. So basically it is the, and she wrote a very good book in the name of women's rights, showing precisely the Islamophobia of, you know, mainstream feminism in Europe, institutionalized feminism. So for example, the feminism of a number of non-governative organizations or of, you know, of government commissions and so on and so on. And no, this is a big problem. And I'm also traveling around Europe. I do find this problem also in public conversations. So in other words, with, you know, for example, last time was in Italy with an Italian feminist asking, but who decides whether the veil could be wear should be wear worn or not, and I was like, not you. I mean, like probably.
Well, I'm not sure who, but definitely not you.
Yeah, exactly. This was my answer. Like, certainly not you. Like, and not me. Clearly, like, so whoever decides certainly is not us. Possibly it is the women who are directly interested by the issue, like who live and experience and who live in Muslim communities or in Muslim countries. This, it is them who have to decide and also to articulate what kind of politics we should have. And of course, the kind of politics you have on issues like this is quite different if you are in Europe or in the United States and if you are in Saudi Arabia. It's not the same kind of phenomenon. In other words, for example, the ban on the hijab in France, in Denmark, in the Netherlands, and so this is really straightforward Islamophobic state policy that has as unique aim that further marginalizing the immigrant communities and Arab communities in this country. This has nothing to do with women's liberation or the Muslim women's liberation. So from this viewpoint, I think, solidarity with the women who in Muslim countries decide to fight against, religion or against the imposition of religious symbols and so on, but also total solidarity with Muslim women in Europe who actually claim the right of wearing a hijab and do not want the state to interfere with this. So from this viewpoint, I think we should just learn to listen, probably also to the women who are already fighting, the Muslims who are already fighting, struggling, organizing, and so on, rather than thinking that we need to educate somebody.
That's wonderful. That's a really nice way to end this. Thank you so much, Cynthia. I'm so happy about this. I'll be talking to everyone. I heard that I think Boitamp was actually giving people like a discount for the book. Oh. So this is excellent. And I'm really happy with how accessible the language is as well. So you three did a really good work on this. Thank you so much. And thank you for talking to me.